come ye all to hear the tale of the Parcher Mama Hunter. Fee-de-la-la-la, fee-de-la-la-la, fee-de-la-la-la. Did he act, remember Transpontina? Fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la 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 la, fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la 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 la. God forbids idolatry, you cannot serve two masters. Fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la la la. The streets of the Roman Amazon with an exorcistic mission. Fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la 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 la, fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la 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 la. In the dark church he could see these ugly Pachamamas. Fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la la la. Them all at once to hurl into the Tiber. Fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la 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 la, fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la 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 la. It was right, it was just, it was good, it was truly an act of reparation. Fide la la la, fide la la la, fide la.
Soon Mary's reign will come and bring back Charlemagne's wisdom. According to a French legend, not far off the coast of Brittany, an ancient city was buried beneath the waters by a mysterious cataclysm. The local fishermen say that when the tide is low on some moonlit nights, the majestic bell tower of a submerged cathedral appears amid the waves. And suddenly, over the crashing of the waves, you can hear the distant but solemn pealing of bells that call to mind the splendor of a glorious and holy past. When the surf is calm, the faint but sublime strains of Gregorian chant or the melodious notes of an organ drift across the sea. The fishermen say that one day the cathedral will return to dry land, even more beautiful, as it is kept unscathed under the waves. Looking at the present crisis, many souls...
Welcome to your Catholic Drive Time, keeping you informed and inspired.
We love God, we ought to be able to talk about Him.
Getting you started on your day.
With the latest in breaking news and information
from the Vatican to the White House and everything in between.
It's serious, it's fun, it's your Catholic Drive Time.
Now here's your host, Joe McClain.
Praise be to Jesus Christ. Welcome back to Catholic Drive Time, keeping you informed and inspired. I'm your host, Joe McClain. So good to be on with you on this Wednesday, November the 16th, on the feast day of St. Margaret of Scotland. Pray for us. Praise be to God. Here is the $64,000 question, all about this brand new book that's just about to drop from Tan, The Devil and Bella Dodd, One Woman's Struggle Against Communism and Her Redemption. Did Bella Dodd actually make the claim that she helped infiltrate Catholic seminaries with some 1,000, 1,200 men? Did she make that claim, number one? And number two, can it be proven that she did actually do that? We're going to have that very pivotal conversation because the debate is hot and heavy on social media amongst Catholics as to whether or not she did claim that, or did she lie about it, and did she do it? Well, this book dives into the details with the nitty-gritty references and everything else. Dr. Mary Nichols and Dr. Paul Kengor. Kengor is going to be on our program at 35 past the hour, so do join us if you can. Coming up at 15 past, Michael Hichborn from Lepanto Institute is back with the latest CCHD report. Spoiler, 30% of this year's grants and more, 30-plus percent, have gone to organizations that oppose Catholic moral teaching. We're going to get the details on that at 15 past the hour. Do join us. David O'Gray is going to be on with us at the top of the next hour. Apparently, the Mormon Church is now embracing LGBTQ agenda and gay marriage. Is this just a stepping stone to getting back polygamy? We'll have that conversation with David O'Gray in the next hour. Lots of stories in the news, of course. Donald Trump has made his official bid for the White House in 2024, while the GOP has taken back the House majority, and they've nominated McCarthy as the next speaker, or at least their nomination for the next speaker. A missel hit a village in Poland. It was apparently made by Russians, but there is some doubt as to who fired it. Moscow has denied it, of course. Joe Biden is even wondering whether or not Moscow fired it. But nonetheless, NATO is convening. They're having conversations. Could this be the spark? I'm sure Rudy's going to cover this story a little bit more. And just days after the midterms, Democrats are moving quickly to codify gay marriage. It's going to be a big vote in the Senate today. They're trying to rush as fast as possible, because they know they've lost the House in the next term. So it's going to be a wild ride. Buckle up. Texas Governor Greg Abbott has declared an invasion and has says he's put into place Article 4, Section 7 of the Texas Constitution. He's calling up the militia. That's interesting. Hey, guess what? The digital dollar is being tested out in the New York Federal Reserve and multiple global banking giants. Nothing to see here. Move along. Move along. Oh, and one last thing. The Archdiocese of Washington, D.C. has canceled the youth rally in Mass for Life because who needs it anymore, I guess? Dobbs, you know, Roe v. Wade got turned over. Anyway, good morning to Rudy Carlos.
Good morning, Joe. And it feels so good to win. You know, we don't need any of that stuff anymore. We're way past it. You know?
What's next? World poverty? I mean, we got this covered now.
Well, our Lord told us that we would have the poor forever. Mm-hmm. So I don't know about that.
Yeah, interesting.
But definitely don't go to California.
Okay.
Because noted. They will allow you to kill your child up to birth now. So.
Yeah. Yeah. And apparently, we had a follow up on that one bill they were trying to pass that allows California to hunt down California residents, even those that aren't living in their own state, and take their kids from them because they don't support the trans thing.
Malone Labe.
We gotta figure out what the status of
come
that is.
Come and take them.
Speaking of coming and taking it, Adrian Fonseca's here on the ones and twos, right out of, is it Goliad or is it Gonzalez? I forget. The come and take it, the cannon.
Oh, Goliad.
Goliad, thank you. Good morning to you, Adrian.
Good morning. Praise be to God. It's good to be here.
Is it?
It is. Praise be to God. And maybe it'll be good to go to D.C. and have a March for Life anyway.
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
That's
yeah.
At the very least, everybody's been talking for years about having a celebratory march after we overturn Roe v. Wade. But also, I don't know if the bishops know, but abortion is still legal in most of the U.S. states. So I don't know if they know.
So we should let
your bishop know today. Hey, by the way,
did you know that
abortion is still legal in the U.S. and we got to get it illegal in every state in our country?
Yeah.
So,
well, for the record, they're only canceling the mass.
Oh, is that all?
Not the march.
Okay. We see we don't need mass.
It's just the mass for the youth. The giant rally that would happen before
you
the march.
You mean the mass that filled up the entire basilica and had people spilling out the doors?
And they would
mass?
Yeah, they have to go to a second site.
Mass is boring, am I right?
Yeah. I mean, like, who needs that, right? Let's pray that that comes back online. Anyway, we have a lot to cover today. Hichborn at 15 past. Kengor at 35. It's going to be a full show. And David O'Gray at the top of the next hour. Let's pray. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thine intercession was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto thee, O Virgin of virgins, my mother. To thee do I come. Before thee I stand sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word incarnate, despise not my petitions, but in thy mercy hear and answer me. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Now your headlines with Rudy Carlos.
Good morning. Thanks for tuning into Catholic Drive Time. Today is Wednesday, November 16th. Breaking news, halfway through the month now. Here are your headlines for this morning. The CNA reports new USCCB President Broglio says, I'd be happy to meet with Biden. Answering more questions, Broglio stood by prior comments he made about homosexuality being related to the sexual abuse crisis that we're seeing. One reporter asked Broglio about a 2018 email he sent in which he said that there was, quote, no question that the crisis of sexual abuse by priests in the U.S. is directly related to homosexuality, unquote. The contents of the email were reported by military.com. He continues saying, quote, I think it's certainly an aspect of the sexual crisis that can't be denied. And that's certainly not to point a finger at anyone, but I think it would be naive to suggest that there's no relationship between the two, unquote. The Epoch Times reports Nevada Supreme Court rejects attempt to stop counties hand count. The hand count, which is taking place after all the ballots cast in the midterms were tabulated with machines, is essentially a recount or an audit, which the ACLU claims is not allowed by state law. The state's top court ruled within hours denying the petition. The court noted that the hand count was approved by the Nevada Secretary of State's office. Breitbart reports U.S. officials now say Poland likely struck by Ukrainian missiles. Biden says it's unlikely that Russia's responsible. Three U.S. officials who spoke on condition of anonymity because they were not authorized to discuss the matter publicly have now briefed the Associated Press that preliminary investigations suggest it was actually Ukraine that struck Poland, likely as a result of anti-aircraft missiles or missiles fired at an incoming Russian bombardment going off course. Breitbart also reports Texas governor invokes invasion clause to push back migrants crossing the border. Governor Abbott's plans include deploying the National Guard to safeguard the border and to repel and turn back immigrants trying to cross the border illegally. Deploying the Texas Department of Public Safety to arrest and return immigrants to the border who have crossed illegally and to arrest illegal immigrants for criminal activity. building a wall in multiple counties on the border, deploying gunboats, and designate Mexican drug cartels as foreign terrorist organizations, enter into a compact with other states to secure the border, enter into agreements with foreign powers to enhance border security, and provide resources for border counties to increase their efforts to respond to the border invasion. Sounds pretty reasonable to me. Those were your headline news this morning. God love you.
The saint of the day is Blessed Lucy of Narni. In Narni, Italy, in 1476, Lucy was born, and when she was just 5 years old, she had a vision of Our Lady. 2 years later, 2 years later, Our Lady came with Saint Dominic, who gave her the scapular. At the age of 12, she made private vows and even at this early age had determined to become a Dominican. However, family affairs were to make this difficult. Lucy's father died, leaving her in the care of her uncle. He felt it that it was best way to dispose of a pretty niece was to marry her off as soon as possible. Her uncle arranged a marriage with Count Pietro of Milan, who was not a stranger to the family. Lucy was, in fact, very fond of him, but she had resolved to live as a religious. The strain of the situation made her seriously ill. During her illness, Our Lady appeared to her again, accompanied by Saint Dominic and Saint Catherine. And they told her to go ahead with the marriage as a legal contract, but to explain to Pietro that she was bound to her vow of virginity and must keep it. When Lucy recovered the matter, she explained to Pietro, and the marriage was solemnized. Pietro, to do him justice, never seems to have objected when his young wife gave away clothes and food, nor when she performed great penances. He knew that she wore a hair shirt under her rich clothing, and that she spent most of the night in prayer and working for the poor. He even made allowances for the legend told him by the servants that Saints Catherine, Agnes, and Agnes of Montepulciano came to her to help her make bread for the poor. When Lucy departed for the desert to become an anchorite, she returned the next day saying that Saint Dominic had brought her home. Pietro's patience finally gave out. He had his young wife locked up. Here she remained for the season of Lent. Sympathetic servants brought her food until Easter. Perhaps they had both decided that Lucy could not live the life God had planned for her in Pietro's house. She returned to her mother's house and put on the habit of a Dominican tertiary. Shortly after this, Lucy went to Vietrobo and joined a group of Third Order sisters. She tried very hard to hide her spiritual favors because they complicated her life wherever she went. She had the stigmata visibly, and she was usually in ecstasy. The Pope himself pronounced in her favor and told her to go home and pray for him. Here, the hard-pressed Pietro had his final appearance in Lucy's life. He made a last effort to persuade Lucy to change her plans and come back to him. Finally, he decided to become a Franciscan, and in later years, he became a famous preacher. The last 39 years of her life, she was never allowed to speak to anyone but her confessor, who was chosen by her prioress. She died in 1544 and was beatified by Pope Clement XI in 1720. Blessed Lucy of Narni, pray for us.
Praise be to God in all things. The gospel today comes to us from John chapter 15, verses 9 through 17. This is the optional gospel. Jesus said to his disciples, "As the Father loves me, so I also love you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy might be in you and your joy might be complete. This is my commandment, love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I no longer call you slaves because a slave does not know what his master is doing. I have called you friends because I have told you everything I have heard from my Father. It was not you who chose me, but I who chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit that will remain, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name he may give you. This I command you, love one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Haydock's commentary today says, this frequent admonition of keeping the commandments proveth that a Christian's life consists not in faith alone, but in good works. Yeah, buddy, it's that key pivotal line there. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Gotta do what he commands. That's the trick. Haydock's commentary goes on to point out a wonderful condescension, says St. Augustine, in our blessed Redeemer, who was God as well as man, to call such poor and sinful creatures his friends, who, when we have done all we can and ought, are still but unprofitable servants. St. Augustine today was on fire. He goes on to say, these words then do not declare whence love arises, but how it is shown, that no one might deceive himself into thinking that he loved our Lord when he did not keep his commandments. Going on to say, continue ye in my love, then is to continue in my grace. Your keeping of my commandments will be evidence to you that you abide in my love. Do you get that? Do you see that? Whew. Living in God's grace is evidence. You must keep his word. You must keep his commandments. You must do as he has asked you to do. We'll be right back. Michael Hitchford, Lepanto is coming up next.
Happy without God? Atheists say yes, we Christians say yes, but only to a certain extent. What's our reason? There are some natural human desires that can be satisfied without living for God. The desire for sensory pleasure, success, and loving relationships. There are certain desires, however, that can't be satisfied without God. For example, we don't just desire some love, we desire infinite love, love without limit. This is manifest when we get frustrated with imperfect manifestations of it. The same is true for knowledge, justice, and beauty. Since God alone is infinite in these perfections, only he can satisfy our desires for them. Therefore, to borrow from St. Augustine, without God, our hearts would be forever restless. And my friends, a restless heart is an unhappy heart. I'm Carlo Broussard with a ready reason for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
For 2,000 years, we've helped the poor and comforted the sick. We've educated generations of children, developed the scientific method and college system. We support marriage and human life. Guided by the Holy Spirit, we compiled the Bible. We are the Catholic Church, with over 1 billion in our family, sharing in the fullness of Christian faith in the church started by Jesus. If you've been away, visit CatholicsComeHome.org today. Welcome home.
Be to Jesus Christ. Welcome back to Catholic Drive Time, keeping you informed and inspired. I'm your host, Joe McClain. So good to be on with you today. Coming up at 35 past the hour, Dr. Paul Kengor is going to be back on the show. And this book, we've been anticipating this book. When he told us he was doing this, my mind was blown. There is a debate in the Catholic world as to the authenticity, the veracity of Bella Dodd's claims that she helped to infiltrate the Catholic Church with some 1,000, 1,100, 1,200 communist men who wanted to subvert the church from within. Did she make the claim? And can it be proven? This book addresses that in detail, all cited with sources. It's good stuff, this book. I have not had enough time with it yet. But nonetheless, this conversation with Dr. Paul Kengor, co-author of this book, is coming up at 35 past the hour. Do join us if you can. Joining us right now, again, is Michael Hichborn, Lepanto Institute. It's that time, CCHD, the Capital Campaign for Human Development, which, by the way, is so its seeds, its beginnings, its origins are also sort of addressed in this book as part of the communist subversion. Good morning to you, Michael Hichborn.
Good morning, Joe. Good to be on.
Yeah, praise be to God. It's good to see you again. How are you, my friend?
Well, you know, fighting a little cold, but that usually comes at the end of a very major project, so.
Yeah, I'm sure. You're wearing yourself out, burning the candle at both ends there.
Yeah.
Now, I find it fascinating. In your report, which can be found at lepantoin.org, you got some bullet points here, and that first one kind of took my breath away a little bit. It says, of the $11,249,000 distributed by the CCHD in fiscal year 2020 to 2021, $3.4 million went to organizations acting against Holy Mother Church, which is north of 30% of the great total. So over 30% of faithfully donated hard-earned dollars into the basket have gone to organizations that actively subvert Catholic Church teaching on morals and faith. Tell us what's going on in the report.
Well, and the thing is that this isn't just like, well, somebody made some statement somewhere that was, you know, not in line with church teaching, which is the way that CCHD would characterize most of our research. We went through and very, very carefully set a very high bar for what we considered a violation of church teaching. And when we're talking about how these organizations were actively working against the church, we're talking about things like going out and participating in these LGBTQ pride fests and going out and posting things on social media saying, hey, there's a pro-abortion rally taking place. We want you guys to all participate. Or going and sponsoring the women's strike, the International Women's Strike, which says specifically that they want to enshrine abortion as a right in law. So when organizations did things like that, that's what we considered a violation. And we found 66 instances of that taking place with CCHD grantees, either directly, you know, they put it on their own social media, or indirectly through coalitions, which is also a violation of the grant guidelines.
Yeah, you say here 47 out of the 66 organizations profiled in this report are in direct violation of Catholic moral or social teaching. That's 71% of all offending organizations. You point out 22 of those violations are abortion related, 6 of those are contraception related, 37 of those are violations are LGBTQ related, 10 of those violations are related to Marxism. Which will tie in nicely to our conversation in the next segment. Is it just that this information was super hard to find, Michael, which is why it took you 6 months to go through it all? I mean, maybe you have to hire investigators. You got to deep dive through data mining. I mean, what does one have to do to find this information? It's got to be too hard for the staff at the CCHD.
Well, it's so hard for the staff at the CCHD that they couldn't even remember that an organization that they had previously defunded, the Chicago Workers Collaborative, defunded because they were part of a coalition that was favoring same-sex marriage. They forgot all about that, and they went ahead and gave them another grant. So that's how hard it was to find this information.
Who was that organization we defunded that one time? I forget. I don't remember. Anyway, here's the check. Have a good one.
Yeah, pretty much. Chicago Workers Club. And the reason that I point that one out is that it is the clearest and surest example of the CCHD just completely blatantly violating its own guidelines. Chicago Workers Collaborative was defunded very publicly. Even Cardinal George commented on it back in 2013 because they refused to leave this one coalition that had taken a position in favor of same-sex marriage. In response, the CCHD hadn't given them a grant until 2019, and suddenly they're back on the grants list. Wow. They're still a dues-paying member of this coalition. In fact, the coalition is now taking a position in favor of abortion. So nothing has changed except for the fact that the CCHD is now giving them money again.
That's incredible. It's hard to believe. Now, I know I've heard this firsthand. Bishops will hear of these reports, but they won't read these reports. Why do you think that is?
Well, I think on the one hand, they're lazy. I think on the other hand, many bishops don't want to know the truth so that they can have plausible deniability. Mm-hmm. And thirdly, I think that many bishops just simply trust their own staff, or they're too cowardly and will only simply go along with whatever they are told.
Wow. That's unbelievable, because
it's tragic.
We're culpable. We're paying for this. Well, I haven't given to CCHD since I've known you, Michael, for crying out loud. Thanks, Mike. I've stopped giving a long time ago now. Which brings me to the next question. How much money has the CCHD lost as a result to your efforts to raise awareness of these troubling issues?
Well, that's difficult to tell, because as a religious institution, the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops is not required to file a tax form 990. Mm-hmm. They do file an annual report where we can see how they break down their budget, but the budget doesn't reflect what they're getting in terms of collections for each of the individual collections. So we don't know what kind of a hit CCHD has taken. The USCCB has maintained roughly the same budget for the last 50 years. Mm-hmm. But I don't know, in terms of real numbers, what the collection dip has been for the CCHD.
Let me ask a quick follow-up question on that then. So is it possible to track how much money they're granting every year to see if that number has fluctuated? Like, oh, we were used to give out more money, but now we're giving out less, or we give out more now versus less earlier. Is there any way to look at it from that perspective?
I've looked at those numbers, and they tend to be in the same ballpark. It's actually increased slightly over the years, but it does fluctuate between 9 or 10 million on the low end to about 14 million on the high end.
Mm. You know, I was listening to some of your other interviews and some of the looking at your reports, and it blew my mind how much money was given to these organizations. You said about 30% of the organizations were not good, and at least explicitly not good. And mm-hmm. The thing was, I used to work for a Catholic charity which would give out money to different Catholic organizations, and a grant of like $2,000 was like, okay, that's a significant amount. A grant of $10,000 was huge. But these organizations were receiving at the low end $50,000. Could you talk a little bit about how much money these individual organizations were receiving, and overall how much money was given to these particular organizations?
Sure. A lot of these organizations have been getting money for well over two decades. And what we've found is that as they've been collecting that money, we tallied up all of the money that all of these 66 grantees have received since 2004, because that's as far back as the CCHD's grants lists go. Collectively, they have all received $16.6 million wow. since 2004. That's a whole lot of money. Most of these organizations we've busted before. You know, we've found them promoting bad things and been involved in bad things, and CCHD doesn't seem to give a rip about what we find. Mm. They just turn around and say, oh, the Lepanto Institute, they overstate things and they misconstrue or take things out of context. I'm sorry, but when I see an organization saying, hey, you should attend this hands off our bodies, hands off our votes rally, how am I supposed to take that out of context? That's a direct statement that you should attend this rally that says we want to enshrine abortion into law. There's no context here. They also get really upset because, well, you didn't contact the organization. I don't need to contact an organization that says you should attend a pro-abortion rally. I don't need to contact them. They've already said what they said.
Have you heard anything positive from any bishop? Has any bishop said, oh, because of your reports, I'm going to pull funding from CCHD, my diocese won't participate? Or the individual priest or individual priest saying, you know, despite the fact that my diocese is taking up collections, I won't be doing this collection in my diocese?
Yes, and it's all done quietly. I've had several bishops tell me that they're no longer taking up the collection, but they won't make a public announcement. And I've had several priests do the same thing.
How much pressure do these bishops receive from superior bishops or from the body, as the USCCB body as a whole, if they don't take up the collection, do you think?
I don't know how much pressure they get, but I can tell you that their reluctance to say anything publicly seems to indicate that there is an awful lot of pressure that comes down on them, yeah. especially since they come out and say things that are kind of unpopular on other topics.
Right. Okay, we have about 2.5 minutes left with Michael Hichborn, so we're running out of time super fast. Who's the worst offender in this report?
Oh, goodness. Well, there's the Ostara Initiative, which its logo is straight out of Wicca. If you look at the organization, even the name is straight out of Wicca. Mm-hmm. But the Ostara Initiative has said multiple times that what they do is they go into prisons and they help women who are incarcerated obtain access to abortion. We've exposed this in 2020. We exposed it in 2021, and they're still getting a grant. I think they're on their third grant now.
Wow. That's unbelievable. And I'm looking through your lepanto.in.org report here, and one of the things that's really nice and super simple is you got a chart with all of the organizations and where they're from, how much money they've got, the issues that they're supporting that are in violation of what we believe in faith and morals. And you can click, you can click their name in the chart and get right down to more information about them in the report itself. So super easy. You could share this with your priest, with your bishop, with your friends and your family so that they know, because that collection for most dioceses is coming up, is it not?
Yeah, it's this weekend for many dioceses. Last weekend, a lot of dioceses already held the collection, but many dioceses around the country are holding the collection this coming weekend. So if they go to lepantoin.org, it's right there front and center. You can just click the link, go to the report, start looking through it. And I highly recommend people contact their priests and bishops and let them know exactly what they're finding and tell them, hey, we need answers for one thing. And second of all, please withdraw us from the collection, because this has been going on for 50 years and nothing's changed.
Yeah, I'm looking at the Ostar piece right now and it's so troubling. I mean, why in the world, with all the options we have and so many people in going who do good things in this world, and you have a list of them on your website as well, why do we choose to give these people our money? It just blows my mind. I can't wrap my head around it. College whiz, please, Lord, save us from this insanity. Michael Hichborn, Lepanto Institute. Go to lepantoin.org for the report, the details, and so much more. Michael, God bless you. God love you. Thanks for being on with us today.
God bless you. God bless your audience.
Coming up right after the break, Rudy Carlos has more breaking news and stories. And Dr. Paul Kengor is on to talk about Bella Dodd.
This is Dale Alquist with a Chesterton Minute. Have you ever noticed that the world associates fanaticism with religion? But G.K. Chesterton says that the strangest fanaticism that fills our time is the fanatical hatred of morality, especially of Christian morality. It is the irreligious who are fanatical in their hatred of religion. They hate religion because religion is the only basis for morality. They hate morality because it is clear. And they prefer things to be vague, vague to the point where they can call wrongs rights. But we cannot call something a right when it defies God's laws. We can only call it a sin, because all rights come from God, and God is not going to break his own laws. Neither should we. Want more than a minute? Visit our website, chesterton.org.
It's to truly save souls. It's to save souls, and we have a lot of different media platforms, whether it's through our TV, radio, music, and it's all promoting this culture that is really here to kill, steal, and destroy souls. And to have that Catholic voice on the air that is proclaiming the good news and able to touch and transform lives, what better thing to support?
The Guadalupe Radio Network, radio for your soul.
Welcome back to Catholic Drive Time, keeping you informed and inspired, and now more headlines. The Hill reports Mormon Church announces support for same-sex marriage bill. The Mormons have come out in support of a proposed law that would protect the so-called same-sex marriages. They say the doctrine of the Mormon Church related to marriage between a man and a woman is well known and will remain unchanged, they said in a statement. The statement marks a shift from 2008, when the church heavily supported efforts to pass Proposition 8 in California, which required the state to recognize only marriages between a man and a woman in attempts to prevent officials from granting so-called same-sex marriage licenses. CNA reports construction workers travel one construction worker travels hundreds of miles by horse to pay homage to the Blessed Virgin Mary. Here's a good news story for you today. Sergio Ariel Ozan, a 58-year-old construction worker from the province of Cordoba, Argentina, traveled more than 180 miles on horseback to visit Catamarca and leave his intentions at the feet of Our Lady of the Valley, the Virgin he said he has carried in his soul since he was a child. The journey began on November 4th when, mounted on his horse and accompanied by his brother Hugo, began to travel to the capital of Catamarca. On the way, they lacked nothing, and there was no inconveniences, a blessing that he attributes to the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary. On the morning of November 10th, on the date in which Argentina celebrates the Day of Tradition,
this Cordovan arrived at the feet of our Lady and said what he felt was indescribable. His devotion to Our Lady of the Valley began many years ago because a chapel in his neighborhood is dedicated to this devotion. There he received the sacraments of Christian initiation, and for that reason he said he carries the Virgin of the Valley in my soul, as if she had raised us like a mother. In his community, Ozan also belongs to a gaucho group that bears the name of the Virgin of the Valley. In Argentina, gauchos are known as countrymen, traditionally dedicated to cattle raising. And those were your headline news this morning. God love you.
Praise be to God in all things. Thank you, Rudy, for keeping us up to date. And boy, whew, I can't wait for this conversation. Dropping tomorrow from Tan Books is The Devil and Bella Dodd, One Woman's Struggle Against Communism and Her Redemption. And I have in my hot little hands here the pre-production copy, which I've been trying to read as much as I possibly could before this conversation. I need more time with it, to be honest with you. But joining us right now is the co-author of the book, Dr. Paul Kengor. He joins us now via Zoom chat. Good morning to you, Dr. Kengor.
Hey, Joe. How are you?
Praise be to God. I'm alive and that counts. How are you?
Doing pretty good. Pretty good.
I'm glad you're here. This is a I've only scratched the surface. I've been trying to read as much as I can. I still need more time with it. There's a lot more to read in this book. But so far, I'm really loving what I'm reading. It's written very well, documented extremely well, very balanced. Because as you know, and as you state in the book, the debate on Bella Dodd within just Catholic circles is pretty intense. I mean, did she make these claims? Did she not? Did she lie? And can it ever be proven? And I love the fact that you were very honest about that debate. You weren't really trying to pick sides as much as trying to see what the evidence actually says and where that led you. Was there any surprises in your research and your time between you and Dr. Mary Nichols in learning something you didn't know before about Bella Dodd?
Well, I was really pleased at how much we were able to document. Now, so Bella, first of all, Bella Dodd was really famous. I mean, she was probably one of the two or three most well-known female ex-communists in the United States, and really the best-known Catholic convert out of communism, which came via Fulton Sheen. I mean, Joe, she testified before Congress over and over and over again mm-hmm. in the 50s, 60s, gave talks around the country. But she's most famous or maybe infamous, right, within Catholic circles for this claim that's attributed to her, where she supposedly said that she helped infiltrate Catholic seminaries with, quote, over 1,000 communist men, unquote. And that's all over the internet. And some of what's reported on the internet, I've been through this so many times. I mean, someone will send you a link
yeah.
and it will be like audio of Bella Dodd talking, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then on the screen comes the claim, the quote of over 1,000 communist men. But the audio stops and it's like, wait, where is it? Where is she saying it? Right.
Yeah.
But so we never found audio of her actually saying this, but she apparently said it to Fulton Sheen. She said it to Dietrich von Hildebrand and Alice von Hildebrand.
Mm-hmm.
Alice, we interviewed for the book. She died at age 98, just last January. Alice said this over and over and over again, on video, online, in print, in memoirs. And we even were able to interview, especially with the help of our good friend Kevin Simmons, Paul and Janine Leininger, who actually heard Bella say this at a speech in California in the 60s. And Joe, they did a sworn affidavit on it,
yeah.
which we quote in the book. And we also met a woman named Sherry Finn, who met Bella with her husband in Plano, Texas, where Bella was teaching in the 60s. Sherry is alive, and Sherry went on record saying that she heard it. And then just to add one more thing. So, I mean, the longest chapter in the book is just on this issue.
I know,
but
yeah.
I
read
Fulton
it.
Fulton Sheen, right after hearing Bella Dodd's confession, Okay. After a year of about instruction with her, he heard her confession April 7th, 1952, then gets on a boat or plane, goes to Rome, speaks at St. Susanna Church in Rome, where he talks about the infiltration happening in, quote, a large American city in the year 1936. What he said in that church, Joe, was on the cover of the New York Times.
Yeah.
I think it was like April 27th, I think, 1952. I have it in the book. So, but she never said anything about it ever again. And we were told by Alice von Hildebrand, among others, that Sheen had told Bella not to name names. And she said, Bishop Sheen, I am ready to go into the most penitential order on the planet and make reparation for all the sins that I've done. Mm-hmm. And he told her, he said, no, don't do that. But what I want you to do, and this is what Pius XI told Fulton Sheen to do in the 1930s. He said, I want you to go tell the world about the dangers of communism and its threat to the church in particular. Mm-hmm. So that was her mission or commission at that point. And man, that's really what she did.
Yeah, I mean, this book, this chapter alone is worth the price of admission, let me tell you. And I think you even state that at the beginning of the chapters, like, I know you're probably reading this book because you want to know this chapter. What was the significance of 1936? It seemed to play a pivotal role in what the Soviets, the communists, had in mind as far as infiltrating the West.
Yeah, we have documentation that the Soviet Comintern was in fact directly infiltrating churches worldwide in 1936. And by the way, we know Joe so well, and I've written about this in many previous books, that they had thoroughly infiltrated and targeted the mainline Protestant denominations. I mean, that's testified over and over again in Congress by Herb Philbrick, Manning Johnson, Ben Gitlow, Louis Boudens. By the way, Louis Boudens also testified to them targeting the Catholic Church. Louis Boudens was another convert of Fulton Sheen, and this one is just great. Sheen brought Louis Boudens into the church while Louis Boudens' name was still on the masthead as the editor of the Daily Worker.
Yeah, yeah, amazing.
Yeah, absolutely beautiful. But 1936 was the year Sheen identified 1936 in that speech in St. Susanna Church, which the New York Times quoted on the front page. And that was the height of Bella Dodd's activism. Mm-hmm. I mean, she led a march of a May Day parade in New York in May Day 1936 with 500 communist teachers.
Wow.
In the state of New York. And she was, this is how it all began for her. She was a very high-ranking member of the Communist Party, probably the leading female comrade at one point. And she was the leading organizer of the Teachers Front. So she was tasked with penetrating and infiltrating the Teachers Union in the state of New York. And of the 10,000 members of the Teachers Union in the state of New York, she said that she placed 1,000 communist teachers in that union. So, by the way, just pause and think about this. 1,000 communist members out of a group of 10,000? Well, and I go through this data in the book, there were about 60,000 priests in America around 1960, around the time of Vatican II. So the party had gone to her and said, oh, great, you placed 1,000 communist teachers in the teachers union. Let's do 1,000 comrades in Catholic seminaries. Bella Dodd would have said, that's a cinch. Mm. You know, that's easy. I mean, I got 10% of the teachers union. Mm. 1,000 out of 60,000 priests, sure, I can do that. So she would have considered it completely feasible as something that was not out of the realm of her possibility whatsoever.
We're down to just a little bit before we have to go to a network break. We're talking with Dr. Paul Kengor. The book is called The Devil and Bella Dodd, One Woman's Struggle Against Communism and Her Redemption. It's published by TAN. It drops tomorrow, and you can find it online at tanbooks.com. I've got the pre-production copy. copy. I can't wait to get the production copy. The cover looks amazing as well. And there's a lot of questions here. Let me just read this quote before we go to the break real quick. This is from a Soviet propaganda study by the Senate Judiciary Committee. It says, in 1955, a former member of the French Communist Party, Albert Vassarot, revealed that in 1936, Moscow had sent out an order to have sure and careful selected members of the communist youth enter seminaries and become priests. Others infiltrated religious communities, particularly the Dominicans. More coming up next.
This is Jesuit Father Robert McTague, host of The Catholic Current, where we bring Christ to the world and the world to Christ. We look at current events through the eyes of faith. I hope you'll join us each Monday and Friday for guests and topics you can't afford to miss. That's The Catholic Current, heard Monday and Friday right here on the Guadalupe Radio Network at 4 p.m. Central, 5 p.m. Eastern.
Hello, this is Steve Gleason with your one-minute tool for Catholic evangelism. Here's the question for your non-Catholic friend. According to 1 Corinthians 11, receiving communion in an unworthy manner can result in sickness and or death. If communion is simply wafer and juice as opposed to body and blood, doesn't the possibility of sickness and death just seem a little over the top? So here's the three best friendship tools for Catholic evangelism. First off, in the Bread of Life discourse in John 6, Jesus says, "He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood dwells in me and I in him." Note, he said drink my blood. He did not say drink my wine or grape juice. Well, no commentary needed there. Secondly, you gonna walk? The disciples did not walk away from Jesus over a symbolic teaching of body and blood. They walked over how literally Jesus was teaching them. Also, they did not walk over the idea that feeding on Christ's body and blood is feeding on the Bible. No, no, no. And thirdly, your new response. My Catholic friend, when you are asked, hey, have you received Christ? Your answer is yes, every Sunday at Mass. That's how I know objectively that Christ is in me.
Jesus Christ. Welcome back to Catholic Drive Time, keeping you informed and inspired. I'm your host, Joe McClain. So good to be on with you. The Devil and Bella Dodd, a brand new book out of 10 books, co-written by Dr. Mary Nichols and Dr. Paul Kengor. We're talking with Dr. Kengor about this book. So let me just set this up real quick, Dr. Kengor. Welcome back, by the way. You know, the question of, did Bella Dodd actually make the claim? You've proven that definitively in the book. I mean, you've given multiple strains of evidence documented. Yes, she actually said that. Then the next question is, well, can it be proven that she actually did it? She might have just been lying, because that is one of the things that people will point out. But golly gee whiz, Dr. Kengor, in 1961, when asked in a Q&A session directly whether or not she ever met a communist in the Catholic clergy, she actually said no. And you address that in this book in quite detail. Can you give us that story?
We go through that at great length. And by the way, let me say here on this show, Joe, that if there's anybody out there alive who's, of course he'd be alive, but who witnessed or heard Bella Dodd say this in any of her lectures, including the one in California in the 1960s, attended by like 600, 800 people in Orange County, please contact me or please contact the show, because I'm sure that there are more people out there. And we're hoping that once this book gets out, people will come out to us and say that, they heard her say this. But yeah, she addressed it in one Q&A. We walked through that very carefully. And I think the question there was something to the effect of, have you ever met communists among the clergy, right? Mm. And she kind of hesitates there. I actually have the transcript right in front of me. It's ironic that you asked this. She said, "I never met a communist who was a member of the Catholic clergy," right? So she's usually very eloquent, and she's hesitating there. Now, keep in mind, Fulton Sheen had told her never to name names, okay? And also at that point in the 1960s, I mean, yeah, she might not have ever actually met somebody who became an ordained Catholic priest that she might have helped recruit. Mm-hmm. And also, too, when we go through this, we even quote people like Solanus Casey, who talked about, he knew of the Red Infiltration. It was well known in seminaries. And Solanus Casey said these people were usually easily exposed once they were in there. One of the beauties of Catholic seminary as compared to some other seminaries and non-Catholic denominations, is it's extremely rigorous, right? And you've got to go through, you've got to be recommended by the rector. I mean, you don't just come in and hang out there for a couple semesters and then pretty soon you have your own church, right? I mean, you got to get up every morning for mass. You got to do the liturgy of the hours. And so how many of these people actually went all the way through and made it all the way through? And then, by the way, by the 1960s, if you were one of those guys that maybe Bella Dodd was in the process of helping to recruit, well, that at that moment, she's famous for being this woman who the FBI and the McCarthy committee called her the Falcon. Right. She wow. She testifies before Congress and exposes people who are communists. So you don't want her to know where you are or who you are at that point. So at that point, yeah, she might not have met any clergy or knew who they were. And also, she doesn't tell us what exactly her role was in recruiting. Just like she did for the teachers unions and other things, she could have been a conduit. She could have been among a number of different people on a committee. I doubt Bella Dodd was sitting there somewhere on the Upper East Side in a building, you know, interviewing and screening and doing multiple interviews with potential infiltrators who went into the priesthood. So she clearly said this. And then the only question is, to what extent were they placed? Did they make it through? And were they successful?
You know, the big question I always had on this whole topic was, every time I always heard that Fulton Sheen converted Bella Dodd and she knew of all these communists, I always wanted to know, why did Fulton Sheen seemingly not do anything about this information? It didn't seem like there was this expose or this attempt to uncover these people and made famous the book Goodbye, Good Men. It is clear that these things were happening, where good men were kicked out of the seminary and bad men were accepted into the seminary. What ended up happening in the church? Because it was very clear about the schools from Bella Dodd, but what had happened in the church with this whole situation?
Well, Alice von Hildebrand said that Sheen and Bella Dodd told her that he was just terribly afraid of causing scandal to the church. And so what he did was he just used the pulpit, his TV show, his radio show, his writings. I mean, he wrote books like Communism and the Conscience of the West, which Tan has just reissued, by the way. And I mean, was there any more prominent clergyman ever in history of the United States on the Catholic side who spoke out more against communism than Fulton Sheen? So, I mean, he went on an absolute, you know, anti-communist crusade to sound the alarm over and over and over again. So he did what he could, and Bella Dodd did what she could too. So about the only thing that they didn't do was go out and name names, right? And again, by that point, I don't even know if she knew who the names were. I should add this too, as somebody whose life has been one researching communism, communists destroyed lists of everything. They didn't keep any of this. To this day, there is no list of actual members of Communist Party USA. Oh, wow. And ask any communist researcher who was asked, well, how many members did Communist Party USA have? People like the late Herb Romerstein, Ron Radosh, and others. Well, I'll say, well, probably in the height of Communist Party USA membership in the 1930s, I don't know, anywhere from 30,000 to 60,000, 50,000 to 100,000. We just don't know. They destroyed all of those records. In fact, in the rap Coderre hearings, Bella Dodd ordered that that documents be shredded. By the way, which was illegal. And she was an attorney, and she knew that was illegal. So if they had any lists of who these clergy were, they would have set them on fire. Wow. Believe me, those kinds of things do not exist to this day. And the party was meticulous, hell-bent on destroying any evidence or paper trail.
So we know your book does a great job of documenting all of this, and you lay the groundwork before jumping into the specifics on the Catholic side. You laid the groundwork of other communist whistleblowers in Senate hearings or in these hearings. And they're saying, listen, we use these techniques to infiltrate Protestant seminaries, labor unions, the teachers unions. And then I sort of asked the obvious question, well, if they're doing all of that and it's documented and it's the evidence you know, shows that, then why wouldn't we believe they did the same thing to the Catholic Church? And then, of course, people bring up that Q&A session that you addressed a minute ago that Bella said, I never met a communist in the clergy. Well, I love what you said when she's like, right after she says that, she has this interaction with Father Keller of the Christophers. And this, I'm going to quote you here. It says, quote, and this is Father, this is Bella talking to Father Keller here. She says, quote, you're forming the Christophers organization. Why don't you establish a national organization so everybody can join? As noted earlier, Keller looked her in the eye and said, Bella, you should know better. In 3 months, they would infiltrate it, and either they would paralyze it or smear it, make it impossible for us to do anything. Close quote. Bella unhesitantly agreed with Father Keller, noting that communists were the best infiltrators that God ever created. Close quote. So, I mean, you can't even use that Q&A session to try to discredit the Bella Dodd story. It looks very clear here. I think the one thing, though, is to be able to make that link between Bella did say she's doing this. It looks like she tried to do this, but and things did happen. And your section, your quote with Blessed Solanus Casey was amazing. That was very clear, very detailed. George Weigel points out that there were, bishops on the take at the Vatican during JP2's reign. Malachi Martin's Book of the Jesuits details the KGB's involvement. You document the KGB involvement with that, the gentleman who came from Prague, who defected from the Soviet Union and dimed out the liberation theology movement. I mean, it's all very, very clear, but I think there maybe lacks that smoking gun of Bella Dodd and the evidence of, like, yeah, seminarian Bob here was recruited by Bella. That probably doesn't exist.
Yeah, it probably doesn't exist. And I would caution people, never take one incident in a Q&A on September 1st, 1961, where she seems to be hesitating and answering a question, and then just ignore everything else from all the other testimonies that she said, from Fulton Sheen, from Alison Dietrich von Hildebrand, Paul and Janine Leininger, Sherry Finn, and all these different people. You can't do that. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to look at the totality of evidence and go back, which is what we did. And also, too, on your point, Joe, we quote in the book Earl Browder, the head of Communist Party USA, who did the infamous outstretched hand to Catholics in the 1930s. And we quote him speaking to seminarians at Union Theological Seminary in New York in 1935. And he says, you may be surprised to know that we have actual preachers active in churches who are members of the Communist Party. So, I mean, that's the head of Communist Party USA,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, they've said this. And we quote Manning Johnson, who testified before Congress. And everybody listening, pause and think about this. This is chilling, okay? He said this, and he left the party, too. He was a famous African-American ex-communist. He said, I know from my own experience working in labor organizations, for example, that we had an organization with 10,000 members, and there were only about 60 or 70 communists, and we controlled the organization. And he said, it is an axiom of infiltrating and organizing that all you need is at best 1% of the membership, highly committed and highly organized, and you can hijack the entire organization.
Yeah.
And it's happened again and again and again, which is why they didn't feel like they needed, 100,000 priests. You know, you just need a handful in the right places. Mm-hmm. And by the way, if you recruit 1,000, you're not going to get 1,000. That's another key thing. You're not going to place all 1,000. But if you can get 50 of them in the right places in the Vatican.
Yes.
Right.
And
that's what you need.
And you point that out, too. You do the math. You're like, OK, 1936, if these guys do make it through seminary, by the time Vatican II comes around, they're monsignors, possibly bishops, and they're having key and pivotal influence in the council itself. And there's a whole section on Vatican II in this book that I got to spend more time on. We'll have to have you back, Dr. Paul Kengor.
Oh, I'd love to come back.
I'm very excited about this book. I'm very grateful that Tan Books sent it to us to review it, to have this conversation. Check it out online, tanbooks.com. It drops tomorrow. The Devil and Bella Dodd, One Woman's Struggle Against Communism and Her Redemption. Dr. Paul Kengor, God love you, my brother. Thank you, and have a great day.
Thank you, Joe. Take care.
All right, that's going to do it for hour number one. What a powerful hour. David L. Gray is going to be on the top of the next hour. Mormon Church embracing gay marriage. What's that about? All that plus the game show and much, much more. Go to grnonline.com/CDT.
Catholic Radio gives us something all day, every day, to fill our lives with our faith. We are completely inundated by the world constantly. Every time you go out shopping, the music that's playing, the visuals that you see, TV, everything, we need Catholicism filling our minds.
The Guadalupe Radio Network, radio for your soul.
Hello, this is Steve Gleason with your one-minute tool for Catholic evangelism. Here's the question for your non-Catholic friend. When you walk into your non-denominational church or your megachurch, what do you see? What stands out to you? Well, here's your three best friendship tools for Catholic evangelism. Number one, observations in a Catholic church. You will notice at least eight items, all of which have religious, historical, or biblical significance. Secondly, what are those items? As soon as you walk in, the can't-miss baptismal font, a stone altar, stained glass windows, 14 stations of Christ's Passion, statues, a gold tabernacle, a lit candle near the tabernacle, and a large crucifix. Thirdly, my take. So, what seems to fill your church and truly move you toward Jesus? Oh, I know you don't need a physical or superfluous objects to move you toward Jesus. He's everywhere and in your heart. And that is true. But tell that to Moses, David, and Solomon, who were under strict and exact directions from God on how to build his house and then fill it with his Shekinah glory. I mean, does a comfy chair, does a flashy Fender guitar, does a well-fashioned stage move you toward contemplation and holiness? Remember, stages are for entertainment, but sanctuaries are for worship.
Donnie, what two important things do we receive when we go to Mass?
Scripture and the Eucharist.
Great job. You're so smart. As parents, we're the primary educators of our Catholic faith to our children. And if you don't know your Catholic faith as well as you should, that's okay. Just tune in daily to the Guadalupe Radio Network by logging online to grnonline.com. The Guadalupe Radio Network. Listen, learn, love, and pass it on.
Are you on the CDT Insider email list? Hi, Joe McClain here. And every week I send you cool stuff straight to your inbox, goodies that you're not going to want to miss. Go to grnonline.com/CDT and get signed up today. Christ, welcome back to Catholic Drive Time, keeping you informed and inspired. I'm your host, Joe McClain. So good to be on with you. Praise be to God. Boy, I kind of wish I had could have read every single page before interviewing Kengor. There was so much to wrap your head around. This book is like, what is that? That's at least an inch and a half, you think?
Nah, that's an inch.
No way. That's totally an inch and a half. Inch and a quarter? Can I get an inch and a quarter?
Whatever this part of your finger is an inch.
Oh, man. I need a ruler. It's thick. Let's just say it. Can we agree it's thick?
Is it big type? What's the size of the type?
I have to wear extra glasses for this. What is that, 10-point font there? I'm not even sure. I don't know. Great book, though. Great, great book. You know, and I find it was just so fairly written, and it addresses all the real arguments and whatever, you know, like, oh, man, it's so good. Really got to get him back. There's so much more I want to ask about how, you know, there's conversation about whether or not Bella Dodd had a child. She got married to a man by the name of John Dodd. There's rumors that they had a child, and they tried to track this information down. It looks as though they probably did have. He's actually measuring it. Adrian's measuring it. Was it an inch?
Inch and a little over an inch.
Little over an inch. I was right.
How many sixteenths?
I nailed it.
Like maybe 2/16.
I nailed it.
It's an inch.
It was closer to an inch and a half than it was an inch.
No, it isn't. An inch and 2/16. Anyway,
so the question was whether or not she had a child. They tried to track this child down. They weren't able to verify any identity. So there was some mystery around that. The Communist Party trying to cover that, similar to some of these other organizations today. Just blows my mind. Blows my mind. There's so much to cover here. And we're gonna have to have him come back and then maybe get into more specifically about how Fulton Sheen played a role in her life and and all that. Here's a question, though. Let me ask you this.
Okay.
Does it bother you that Fulton Sheen forbade her from naming names? He names a couple of names, by the way, in the book. A couple of clergy member names are named in the book.
So I'm trying to wrap my head around why she had this gag order, mm-hmm. right? She wouldn't talk about it. Mm-hmm. She wouldn't do anything about it. I think that Fulton Sheen was a patriot. And the only thing that makes sense to me about that, and if I could tie that into this situation here, I think he probably thought that if she said something, it would compromise the investigations that were already taking place into these communists.
Yeah.
So he probably said, don't say anything that's going to get taken care of, but it didn't.
I think my bet is on what Paul Kengor was saying, that it was the whole point of scandal, that he just didn't want to scandalize the church.
That could be too.
And I think that was the whole worldview. That really has been the whole worldview of the church up to today.
Yeah.
And that's why it was
norm. But doesn't
that
frustrate you, though?
It does. It is frustrating, but, you know, it's not.
It lacks foresight. It lacks foresight, I think.
I understand.
In one sense, it's
good. I understand. Because the same thing with Padre Pio. There was a particular archbishop and a priest who tag-teamed to try to suppress him. They did not like him at all. Mm-hmm. And they had some powerful friends at the Holy Office at the Vatican. And they leveraged that to manipulate the Pope to suppress him. And then one of Padre Pio's devotees, who maybe had less scruples and obedience than Padre did, dug up all the perverse dirt on these particular prelates and published a book about it, and the Vatican bought every copy. And then when this guy's like, oh yeah, well, I'll hold a press conference and tell the whole world, they forced Padre Pio to call this guy at the day of the press conference and call it all off, which Padre did, and because there was like, hey, listen, we're not going to have any public scandal in the deal. And I can appreciate that, but nonetheless, the wolves are inside the sheep pen, people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, we got to do something.
Yeah, I think I am very conflicted about it because, you know, it's a very American mindset that we want everything. We want as much information, freedom of speech. Everything needs to be out in the public. Mm-hmm. And it's a very American mindset. However, it's at the same time, you know, I think the balance might be, if there are people who are doing something about it, then it's okay to keep it under wraps and try to work in-house. But if no one's doing anything about it, then it needs to be exposed.
Yeah.
And I think that might be a more balanced idea. So I don't know if I agree or disagree with Fulton Sheen's tactic. I don't know. He may have been done the right thing. Okay. I don't know.
Okay.
That's what I
say. Well, dear listener, you can let us know what you think in the after show, second half of this hour on one of the live video feeds. Just go to grnonline.com/CDT. You can check out one of the live video feeds, comment directly your thoughts. But joining us now, all the way, speaking of American, all the way from Deutschland, our good friend, David L. Gray. Good morning to you, David.
How's it going, gentlemen?
Praise be to God. We are alive, and that counts. How are you?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here. I'm doing great. It's about 2 o'clock in the afternoon here. I just had some Popeyes, and now I'm on a Catholic Drive Time show.
Popeyes in Germany?
on base, they do.
Yeah. Oh, I see. Now, have you already begun the process of drinking Fanta?
Oh, wow. Yeah, you know about this.
Of course. I live there. Of course. Man, Fanta. Good stuff, Fanta.
Yeah, or Fanta, as they call it here, Fanta.
Yeah. Font. What do they know? I call it Fanta. Now, what is your opinion? Do you think Bella Dodd should have named names? Do you think it was prudent to keep that information secret until her death, or do you think she should have?
Joe, you know I'm all about dropping names. If you don't drop a name, you know, how legitimate is your information?
You got to keep the receipts.
You got to drop a name.
Yeah.
But I like what you said about you or Rodolfo, you're saying that, well, maybe that they were trying to protect, you know, the whole communist thing that was going on with the investigation at that time. I think that's a reasonable argument why she wouldn't. But, you know, it'd been great if she did. At least write them down somewhere. Make it like the fourth secret of Fatima or something. Like just drop. Just write down the list of names.
We would be debating that then. That would be a debate all by itself. Speaking of debates, it seems interesting to me. You know, when people think of the Mormons, they think of them as family friendly. Like that's a common theme you're going to hear a lot when people comment and talk about the Mormons. Oh, they're very family focused, very family friendly. Well, they just came out in total support of same-sex marriage bill, which, by the way, the Senate is trying to cram through today in a vote. And there are many Republicans who are going to support that. Just keep that in mind. But I find this bizarre. Did you see this story? And what were your thoughts, David O'Gray?
I thought it was really just a change in their previous position. It goes along with how fast this whole agenda has been moving. Under two decades ago, I mean, the Mormons and the Catholic Church, they were working hand in hand in California to stop, I believe at that time was a Proposition
Prop 8,
I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so they're working hand in hand to stop that. So now, as you say, so the Respect for Marriage Act, which has been in Congress a long time and looks now to be close to passing, what it's going to do is going to repeal the 1996 Defense of Marriage Act. And it's going to require all U.S. federal governments, the U.S. government, to recognize the validity of same-sex marriage and interracial marriage. And so this has been a big push ever since Dobbs v. Jackson and Clarence Thomas. Just Clarence Thomas was saying, hey, we repealed, we turned back this. Abortion is not in the Constitution, but neither is marriage in the Constitution, neither is same-sex marriage. So they've been pushing this. And it does have a compromise in there. They've reached a compromise so that this amendment act is not supposed to infringe upon religious freedom. The Mormon's position is that, yeah, we still define marriage as being between man and woman or women's, depending upon, where they want to land on that. But long as this doesn't interfere with our religious freedom, we're okay with the government redefining marriage. It doesn't really affect us. So they want to keep their position and then allow us and then say, well, government, you can have your own position, which is a really strange way to consider truth. I think if something is true, mm-hmm. then it's worthy of defending in season and out of season. Amen. So now we just have to question whether what they really believe about marriage being between one man and one man and woman is really what they believe or are they really just falling into just secularism and relativism?
Well, some are saying that it's possible that the Mormon Church is coming out in support of this same-sex marriage bill because they might see it as a stepping stone towards having polygamy back legally. Because once you've taken away the standard, well, then aren't all options on the table? And if you're going to marry same sex, then why can't you have multiple wives or, I guess, multiple husbands? I don't know. Have you thought about that, David O'Gray?
Yeah, I think we have to remember that the Mormons' position in the late 1800s only changed because the laws of the government had changed. And so here we are in the late 1890s, and there was the laws of the government was changing. They were starting to be persecuted. In fact, some of their land was starting to be seized, and they were scared their temples were going to be seized. And so what they thought was a revelation from God that a man can have multiple wives, they changed that because it became more expedient for them not to. So their position only changed because the law had changed.
Yeah.
So now we know that this is a slippery slope, as we like to say. We know that, this probably is going to lead to once you start redefining marriage, this is going to, we're going to keep redefining it. So, yeah, this could be a backdoor way to reinstitute their belief that one man can have multiple wives. It's pretty clever if that's the case.
Now, I just don't understand these so-called conservatives that will support this. I mean, if you're not conserving marriage, then I find it suspect that you claim to be conserving the life issue with abortion because they're linked. I mean, life comes from a man and a woman, and they ought to be married. And that is the foundation, not just of life in the world, but of society itself. So if you tear apart that foundational stone of society, then I just don't think that we are going to truly have a pro-life world in front of us. How do you see it, David O'Gray?
Yeah, I agree 100% with you. Once you redefine marriage, redefine family, but marriage has been redefined so many times. It's redefined when free will divorce was allowed. It's been redefined with contraception. Then it was marriage again, redefined with abortion. Marriage and family, as you say, they go hand in hand. So I'm not surprised that we have many politicians in all these the political parties. Surprising, yes, the Republicans, but I'm not surprised that you do have these small groups that continue to be more inclined to go along with the world than divine revelation. And like what I think what your previous guest said was that what Bella Dodd, what she was, what one of her interviews was saying, it only takes, you know, just a little bit of yeast, right? Yeah. Just a little bit of yeast. Yeah. Just takes a couple. And so, yeah, you do, I mean, you just need a couple of Republicans to just really sell out the whole world, whole society, government.
Yeah, it ought to be very interesting. I mean, I think they really are trying to make sure that they codify this before the Obergefell decision gets repealed like the Roe decision did. So let's pray, fast, and do penance, because that vote's happening today. No matter how you voted in the midterms, that vote is happening today nonetheless. That's pretty scary. But almost out of time here with David O'Gray. So how's Germany going for you right now? Did you get a job? I mean, like, what's life like for you over there right now?
Well, I was doing a whole trophy husband thing. Got bored working out.
And, you know, I think you make a great trophy
every day,
husband.
Shopping. But I got a really, so I'm working, you know, doing substitute teaching, and I'm also a pastoral life coordinator at the biggest, you know, Catholic community in the military. So it's a really, amazing. It's a really cool job.
Yeah. Praise be to God. Congratulations. Yeah. Have you adjusted to the German culture?
You know, but now, Joe, I'm around Americans most of the day, right?
So. Really?
It's
come
different
on,
now.
Man. You got to get out more. Yeah. When are you going to take your first road trip and go see that?
Oh, we've been up to Luxembourg. I did the Luxembourg thing. Took a train there.
Hey, now.
Went to Holy Mass in French. It was in French language.
Nice.
And like, the priest could have been saying all types of heretical things. And he could have said the next pope should be a woman.
It was the DJ priest.
It sounded really good. I mean, the French language is so beautiful.
It is.
So
it is
enjoy
quite
that
lovely.
Trip to Luxembourg.
All right.
So.
Enough shenanigans. David L. Gray, davidlgray.info. God love you, David. Thanks for hanging out with us and having a chat today. We look forward to having you back next week. All right. Time to play our game show, Fear and Trembling. Well, you might learn, you might laugh, and you may even win prizes. It's a lot of fun. If you would like to play, call right now. Phone lines are open for you at 877-757-9424. First caller gets to play the game at 877-757-9424. That is 877-757-9424. Call right now.
The Bible says to call no man father. So why do we call our priests father?
In Matthew 23, verse 9, it says, "And call no man your father on earth, for you have one father who is in heaven." Notice that this verse makes no distinction between spiritual fathers, which is what priests are, and biological fathers. This passage says that no man is to be called father. Therefore, you cannot distinguish between calling a priest father and calling the man who is married to your mother father. But is that actually what this passage is saying? Or is Jesus warning us against trying to usurp the fatherhood of God, which is what the Pharisees and scribes were doing? They wanted all attention focused on them. They were leaving God, the Father, out of the equation. And even if you just interpret this passage from Matthew 23 as an absolute ban against calling anyone your spiritual father, then there are some problems for you in the rest of Scripture. For example, Jesus, in the story of Lazarus and the rich man in Luke 16, has the rich man referring to Abraham as father several times. Paul in Romans 4 refers to Abraham as the father of the uncircumcised, the Gentiles. Spiritual fatherhood, not biological fatherhood. In Acts 7 and then in Acts 22, first Stephen and then Paul refer to the Jewish priest and elders as brothers and fathers. Spiritual fatherhood. So if you interpret Matthew 23 as saying we cannot call anyone our spiritual father, then you have to believe that Jesus, Paul, and Stephen all got it wrong. It is okay to call priests our spiritual fathers today. We are simply imitating the example given us by Jesus, Paul, and Stephen, all of whom who used the term in a spiritual sense. As long as we remember that our true father is God the Father, and that all aspects of our fatherhood, biological and spiritual, are derived from him.
A beacon of truth in a troubled world. This is the Guadalupe Radio Network, radio for your soul.
Welcome to another round of fear and trembling, the Catholic trivia game show that helps you work out your salvation by the seat of your pants. It's a 50-50 chance and prizes are involved. Avoid the weeping and gnashing of teeth. Call now to take your shot, 877-757-9424. And now, your host, Joe McClain.
Praise be to Jesus Christ. Welcome back to Catholic Drive Time and fear and trembling. Catholic trivia game show.
You feeling okay, Jack?
What
secrets is that about?
You having a hard time breathing?
It's fear and trembling. So we're fearing and we're trembling. But nonetheless, there are some things we like to do on the game show. Number one, we like to teach the faith. So we do that in a sneaky little way. You might learn something you didn't know before about the Catholic faith, and praise be to God for it. And then, of course, we like to have a laugh, a chuckle, a good time, and our callers laugh with us. We enjoy that most, I would argue. And then we give out prizes, which means we are manipulated. I mean, which means you could win. You could laugh, and you could learn. You see, it's a winner for everybody involved. But here's the kicker. The secret sauce in all of this is we don't ask the caller. They may not know a single correct answer, but could still win our game. Because instead of asking them, I shall ask Rudy. I shall ask Adrian. One of which will give us a correct answer. The other will give us an incorrect answer. The caller will then have 15 seconds to make a decision. Whomst do they trust more, Rudy or Adrian? Every correct answer at that point will go into the coffee cup at Divine Providence to win this week's prize. Rudy, what could they win?
Praise be to God. You ever been in Mass and you're thinking to yourself, wow, Father's really, really dropping a truth bomb right now. I got to remember this. And then you go home and you're like, oh, what did he say? Oh, what was that inspiration? Well, that's going to change, because if you win this week's prize, which happens to be the Every Sacred Sunday Mass Journal, you're going to remember all of those inspirations because you're going to be able to write them down next to all of the readings that are available for every Sunday Mass. This Every Sacred Sunday Mass Journal actually is for, it's for the female variety here. But I suppose if you're a man, you could put a book cover on it and still use it. Or you can give it away. But this prize was generously given to us by Gloria Lopez. And we just want to say thank you so much for giving us something to give away for our game show this week.
Thanks, Rudy, for alienating every guy.
Not but exactly. You could give it away as a gift. Christmas is right
are
around
you
the corner.
Are you a journalist? I mean, do you journal? Have you ever journaled?
Am I a journalist?
Do you journal?
Wife, girlfriend, daughter, sister?
There's always somebody we can give it to.
That's true. Okay. No, I am not a journalist.
Not a journalist. Interesting. We should talk about that in the after show. How many guys out there are journal? Do they journal?
I used to do it when I was doing the spiritual exercises. But
okay, yeah, that can make some
not
sense
typically.
There. Let's go to the phones. Colbe, good morning to you. Thanks for being on our program.
Good morning.
Praise be to God, Colbe. I love your name, by the way.
Thank you. I'm actually named after St. Maxbury Colby.
Amen. I have a son named
I was thinking
Saint
Colby
Max.
Cheese, but that makes way more sense.
That's pretty close.
Where are you calling from, Colbe?
I'm in San Antonio, Texas. I go to St. Joseph's Honey Creek.
Hey now, praise be to God. Now, you realize, Colby, that San Antonio, Texas is an amazing town, and it's not just because I'm from there, right? There are other reasons, too.
It's because of the Smith & Valley Rangers?
I hadn't heard that one before, but I do know that the Mighty Judson Rockets, they hail from there, so praise be to God.
They do.
Yeah, yeah, true story. All right, Colby, are you familiar with the game? Do you know how this whole thing works?
Oh, yeah, we listen every day.
Oh, well, praise God. We're grateful to you for listening every day. Let's see if we can't get you in the cup with a good amount of opportunity today. We're going to start with Brother Rudy Carlos, and you should know, Colbe, he has gone back to his old ways. he's not just wearing a jacket today, but he's wearing a bow tie too.
All right.
So take that into consideration.
It's blue.
What is the tie?
The bow tie.
The bow tie. It's what are those? The paisleys again?
This is a foulard pattern.
A what pattern?
A foulard pattern.
A foulard?
That's right.
Foulard?
Foulard.
Is that French or?
I think so.
Foulard.
Foulard.
Foulard?
Okay. I don't know what it means. Don't ask
Neither
me.
Do I. Hopefully that's not a question you have to ask. Like, that's not one of the questions, right?
That's the first question.
What is foulard? Okay, that's not. All right, are you ready, sir?
I am ready.
Let's go with the easy one first.
All right.
Who is the patron saint of secretaries?
The patron saint of secretaries and other things. Kind of a strange combination of other things like comedy, comedians. It's Saint Genesius.
Saint Genesius?
Maybe there's some sort of connection between being a funny guy and being a secretary.
Like funny I amuse you?
Something like that.
Funny haha?
Hey, can you give me that document? Can I?
Okay, Saint Genesius, you say.
Saint Genesius.
All right, let's just see. Adrian, I know that you are funny. I watch your Twitter feed carefully, so that's how I know it. But could you tell me, who is the patron saint of secretaries?
Well, my dad did say that I was funny looking, so. But I like to inform him that I look like him. The patron saint of secretaries is Saint Scholastica.
Why did you say it like that?
I have no idea. Why did you introduce the show like that?
Because it's fear and trembling, for crying out loud. It's context, my friend. All right.
It just sounds like you're out of breath.
Okay, my man here. You said the patron saint of secretaries was Saint Scholastica?
That's right.
Saint Scholastica. All right, Colbe in San Antonio. Great town, by the way. Who is the patron saint of secretaries? Adrian seems to think it's Saint Scholastica, whereas Rudy is suggesting it's Saint Genesius. 15 seconds on the clock. Who's right? Who's wrong? Colby, what say you?
I'm going to go with Rudy.
Wow. Was that enough time for you to Google that, Colby? I mean, no way you could have known that ahead of time, right?
I just wanted to go with Rudy.
Okay.
What a guy.
What a guy. Smart move. Mm-hmm. All right. Let's see if we can't get you in there twice, because that is the correct answer. Saint Genesius is the right answer. But let's see here. Okay. A sacramental question. Adrian? Okay. You ready?
Yes.
What is the term for a recipient of the sacrament of penance? What do we call that?
Yes. The term for a recipient, meaning the person who receives the sacrament of penance, is the milstonated.
The milstonated. Whoa. That verse just popped into my head.
Yeah, I know.
Better than to be never born. Then
you better get to confession. Or you might be milstonated.
Tossed into the ocean. Okay, milstonated. Milstonation? Milstonate? What was it?
The milstonated.
The milstonated guy.
I hear they throw him in the Mariana Trench.
Wow. That's deep. That's deep and profound. Rudy, can you tell me, what is the term for a recipient of the sacrament of penance?
A penitent. I'm sorry.
Are you?
You should have done the breath thing.
Is that like required or? That was a good one. Hats off. All right. What is the term for a recipient of the sacrament of penance, Colby? Rudy says it's called penitent. Mm-hmm. Or is it milstonated, as Adrian is suggesting? 15 seconds on the clock. Who's right? Who's wrong? Colby, what say you?
With Rudy again.
Wow.
Are you sure? Yeah.
Wow. Penitent is the correct answer. Well played, sir.
No one's
next time you say
milstonated.
Next time you say a correct answer, say Colby.
Praise be to Jesus. All right, you're in for two. We could go for a third perfect game today, a perfect third correct answer, perfect game. But I'm going to be honest with you. This could be a tricky question.
This is the easiest question we've ever had.
Yeah, take note of who said that.
It's so easy. Mm-hmm. The only way you can get this wrong is if Joe tricks you.
No way. No way. I'm on your side, Colby. You know that, right? It's just me.
Like a good neighbor.
And you.
Just like a good neighbor. Joe McClain's there.
All right, here we go. Back to Rudy Carlos.
Okay.
Now, Rudy. Okay, Rudy. What is the name of the largest church on planet Earth.
I'm laughing because it's in the middle of nowhere.
Is it?
What? It's Our Lady of Victory Basilica in Lackawanna, New York.
Are you? What?
Wow. Lackawanna?
Lackawanna.
Lackawanna.
Lackawanna, New York.
Lackawanna, New York.
Like I want to be there.
I got it. Okay. Our Lady of Victory, though. I like the title. Quite nice. You're saying it's a basilica.
Yeah.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Okay. Our Lady of Victory Basilica, Lackawanna, New York, you say. Okay.
And it's the biggest by just 2 inches, so.
What?
Wow.
Who pulled out the tape number. Measure for that?
They're like.
Like Texas, like Austin's yeah, Capitol
like
building.
Yeah, flagpole, okay. Right?
All right, Brother Adrian, let's see what you have to say here. I know that you have advanced degrees in big churchology, so hopefully you might be able to help us out here. Dr. Fonseca, could you tell me what is the name of the largest church on Earth?
Yes, well, as someone who identifies with a PhD in largest church, specifically largest church,
that was my
PhD, yes.
Okay, yeah.
That would be St. Peter's Basilica, and I actually have been to Lackawanna.
Okay, that's a little on the nose there.
St. Peter's Basilica.
All right, Colbe, is it St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, as Adrian suggests, or Our Lady of Victory Basilica in Lackawanna, New York? 15 seconds on the clock. Who's right? Who's wrong? Colbe, what say you, good sir?
Well, never been to Rome yet, and of course, that's where the mother house is, so I'm going to go with Adrian.
Way to go, Colby!
Like the qualification,
Colby. Good job. Wow. You know, my sister's painting an awesome painting of Max Colby right now.
You know what Colby didn't say? He didn't say Adrian is correct.
Wow! I hear him say it all the time.
He just said, "I have to go."
Don't worry, Colby.
I'm forced to go.
Don't worry, Colby. You're now smarter,
beyond
faster, stronger, wiser, more handsome, younger.
My
all by going
are
with Adrian.
Tied. I have to admit, Adrian is correct.
It's true.
Got high tea.
St. Peter's Basilica was the correct answer, as the largest church on Earth, and I have been there. It is a blessed, incredible place to go. God bless you, Colby. You were fun. Thanks for playing our game. You got all three right. You're in the cup. You might win, sir.
Thank you. It was fun.
Colby, have a great day. And again, thanks for listening. We appreciate having you on the team. I'm going to put you on hold. Don't go anywhere. That's going to do it for the radio side of our show. We'd love to hear from you, dear audience. What did you think about our Bella Dodd conversation, or our Hichborn, or our David O'Gray conversation? Comment in the live video feed at grnonline.com/CDT. We'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you for joining us on Your Catholic Drive Time, where it is our pleasure to keep you informed and inspired.
Join us Monday through Friday at the same time, right here on your favorite Catholic radio station.
Don't forget to connect with us. Just go to facebook.com/CatholicDriveTime.
Again, that's facebook.com/CatholicDriveTime.
Be sure to share more than just us today. Share Jesus with everyone you meet.
Bye now, and God love you.
Praise be to Jesus Christ. Welcome back to the after show of Catholic Drive Time, where we get a lot more casual about the conversation, and you get to drive it to whatever direction you want to go. I see fake news and spam bots already in the YouTube chat. That didn't take long. A supposed Eric Rodriguez, clearly a Russian spam bot, says Tricky Joe. Fake news. Totally fake news.
I told you guys.
Totally fake news.
I told you.
I don't know what you've done with Eric Rodriguez, but can we get him back, please?
I'm telling you. Jesus Robles, our dear friend, said, my daughter said Rudy looks like a scientist.
He does.
That's about to win the Nobel Peace Prize. He said, I feel so young that I grew a hair in my bald spot. Thank you, Adrian.
Wow. Well,
it's true. It's true. By going with Adrian, your hair grows back.
So you're saying.
It's pretty awesome.
What you're trying to say.
That's
here.
Why Joe's going bald.
If I just simply admit that Adrian is correct, my hair will regrow.
Yes.
On top of my head.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Joe's like, not worth it.
Yeah. Embrace the bald is what I say. I love that, Jesus. My hair grew in my bald spot. It's just classic.
A single
it's
hair, stuff. Though.
Hey, what? I mean, Odyssey. You let us down today, Odyssey.
Not only Odyssey, Rumble. Rumble stopped. So this is the wild thing. It stopped working halfway through the Paul Kengor interview.
What's up with that?
And then it started working again during the David O'Gray interview.
Oh, that's a shame. Really is a shame. So what did you guys think of Bella Dodd? I mean, we only scratched the surface. This book has so much more to offer. I'd never seen the blessed Casey comment about the communists and seminaries.
That doesn't surprise me.
So very, very telling there. Great book. Very, very good book. I can't wait to finish reading it, to be honest with you. And I just want to keep talking to Paul about it. So good. Let us know what you guys thought. Do you guys believe Bella Dodd? Do you not believe Bella Dodd? I'd like to know either way. Just leave a comment below.
Hey, did you guys know that Stephanie Meyer's book series, The Twilight Saga, the main character, Bella, was inspired by Bella Dodd?
Are you kidding?
He's joking.
No, I'm serious.
I've never even watched The Twilight, so
it's horrible.
I would have not known that. Okay. Junior Barra, Patty, good morning to you. Lori, good morning to you. Don, Annette, Padilla, welcome back. Good morning. It's good to see you. Of course, Jesus Robles, Kim Wilcox.
Where's Polo Chicho?
Gloria Deanne Lopez, Joaquin, and Sharon, good morning to you. Thanks for hanging out with us. Martin on Rumble, thanks for commenting today. Appreciated having you on in the comment box there. I see VT Farm Boy. Is that Vermont Farm Boy? VT or?
Joe, do you know who the Three Hearts Institute is?
I've heard of the Three Hearts Institute, but I'm not only vaguely familiar with it.
Okay.
Lace Dragonfly, good morning to you. Sci-Fi Mike, The Brick Wall, we're commenting on Rumble today. Clarissa was there. Good morning to you. Thanks for hanging out with us today. I don't know what. I wish we had a solid alternative. Here's a question. Should we stream on Gab? I think you can. Can you stream on Gab if you pay for it?
I've never seen anything on Gab. I've only been to Gab Trends, so.
I have a Gab account. I never post. I mean, I shouldn't say never. I rarely post there, but is live streaming an option there is the question. I don't even know. I have to check it out.
They're in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. I bet our buddy Dave Palmer knows them.
Probably. That's a good place to ask.
The reason why I ask is I just got a message from Three Hearts Institute, which is kind of random because I had never interacted with them before.
Yeah.
They said, "Hi, Adrian, do you have something recent in the recent past about marriage not being a vocation? If so, could you please send me the link? Thank you." And I'm like, that's kind of sus.
Marriage not being a vocation?
Yeah. Well, because I've said that in the past. I've said marriage isn't a vocation in the same sense that we mean a religious vocation, because vocation refers to a calling out of, and it's according to the nature of man, according to natural law, to get married.
You can't comment on that because you're not married.
Yeah, I've heard. But yeah, naturally speaking, everyone is called to marriage, and then some are called out of marriage to a higher life, which is religious life. And so that's traditionally what is referred to as a vocation. And we've kind of stretched the word vocation now to mean your job, your marriage, what your particular things that you do. It just has been overstretched to mean whatever, pretty much anything. So everybody's always discerning their vocation. But traditionally,
I'm still discerning my vocation, just so you know.
I figured.
Tammy says, Twilight series was written by a Mormon. Never read or watched anything to do with vampires. She said the story came to her in a dream. She wrote it for her family, and they convinced her to publish.
Huh.
I wonder if she saw it not in a dream, but in some stones, golden stones.
Golden tablets, possibly?
Yeah, you can only see them if you put your head
by an angel
in a hat.
Yeah, I see. Hey, Jesus Robles asks deep and profound questions on behalf of his daughter. Wants to know what y'all's favorite food and animal was.
Food and animal?
Food was what my mom made last night.
Oh, man,
your favorite food is enchiladas. What your mom makes.
My mom made enchiladas.
Any food that you don't have to buy
and
or make
so
is your favorite.
So good. Enchiladas, so good. And if it's not my mom's enchiladas, it's a pizza.
Is that really your top one S-tier?
Yes, the best.
Enchiladas?
Food. My mom's enchiladas, specifically.
I got to tell you.
Specifically my mom's enchiladas.
I love enchiladas. And that's probably my favorite Mexican
it's
dish.
It's so good.
That was my first meal in Texas.
Really?
Yeah, enchiladas.
Was it good or was it not good?
They were the cheesiest enchiladas I've ever had.
Where did you
get
buy
cheese
them?
Enchiladas?
They were at Papacito's.
Oh, okay.
In the airport.
Yeah, I've had Papacito's enchiladas. They're very good.
Super cheesy.
Eh. Very good.
What's yours, Joe? Your top one S tier.
Well, enchiladas was the one thing I craved most at boot camp.
And so I went looking when I got out, when I graduated boot camp, I walked the mean streets of San Diego looking for great Tex-Mex food and didn't find it. Instead, I found an authentic Mexican place that made real Mexican food. And I was like, what is this? Like, good grief, man.
Real Mexican food is not good, man.
Yeah.
It's all about Tex-Mex.
It's all about Tex-Mex.
Tex-Mex is where it's at.
It's where it's at.
I'm going to put an asterisk there, Adrian. Mm-hmm. Real Mexican food in a restaurant is not good. It has to be homemade.
Mm-hmm. If you say so, but I can't confirm or deny that because I never had it.
So, homemade. Favorite animal?
My favorite animal, it used to be a shark. I used to have tons, like when I was a little kid. I had
a little shark stuffed animal.
Adrian
shark.
And we went to a pottery thing. And when I got, I painted the painted pottery, whatever it's called. I made a little shark thing.
Wow.
So I used to love sharks.
So you got
then it was wolves.
Chased by one.
And then when I was really little, my aunt, when I was like 1 year old, my aunt bought me the stuffed elephant. And so elephants used to be my favorite animal.
Okay.
Currently though, I don't know. I don't really think about it.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's maybe a wolf still, I guess a wolf.
I like deer.
But you like eating deer.
Yeah, that's true. They're both my favorite food and my favorite animal.
You know? My favorite food is meat and potatoes made by my mom, Mrs. Lazarga.
How'd she do it? Does she have a secret?
It's basically beef and potatoes. And then she makes this tomato salsa that she then incorporates into it. And it just, it comes together in a very lovely way. Now, my favorite animal would be a Shiba Inu dog.
Shiba Inu dog.
That's so California.
I love Shiba Inu dogs.
That is California.
These dogs are awesome. They're hilarious.
Yeah. If we're saying it's favorite dogs, my favorite dog is a Pomsky. It's a husky with the size of a Pomeranian. It is the most adorable thing ever. I wouldn't really want one because like it's kind of a useless dog, but they're so cute. I can't get over it. They're really adorable.
I can't take Pomeranians seriously. After that one time I went to confession and the priest brought in a Pomeranian.
No way.
Yes.
That's not the Pomeranian's fault.
He had a Pomeranian in there and I was like, dude, come on, man. It's barking. Stop.
I knew a priest who allowed his dog to walk the church all the time with him.
Dude, don't let animals into this church. What's wrong with
I saw
people?
That too. I saw somebody with a dog in the sanctuary.
Stop.
Seems strange.
It's like, Father, just leave it in the rectory. What's wrong with you?
Yeah, like let it hang it out in the backyard or whatever.
What would Jose Sanchez de Rio do?
What would he would do?
Jose Sanchez de Rio
plucked up the eyes of the horses.
Yeah, he broke the necks of the roosters that were in the fighting roosters.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. He was what, 12 at the time?
Yeah. No, he was 13.
Oh, my mistake.
Come on.
Sorry.
12.
Sorry.
Please.
I thought he was a child, man, but clearly he was a
grown man. By
sorry.
That point.
My mistake.
Yeah, he feigned having to go to the bathroom so they would let him out of the sacristy. and then he went and plucked the eyes out of the horses and strung the neck of the roosters.
Just came back with a bloody hand.
And they're like, what are you doing? He's like, get these animals out of God's house.
Yeah.
Bring it.
What would our Lord do to these priests who are bringing their animals into the father's house?
He made it worse, too, because the horse started going,
how's it go?
Something like that.
Because remember, what did our Lord do whenever they had animals in the temple?
Yeah,
He drove them out. That was the temple that just symbolized God.
Yeah, exactly.
And the house of God now is, he's really present there. So imagine what our Lord would do.
Yeah.
Wait, he's really present there?
He's really present there.
Wow, yeah. I think that people would have know that.
Yeah, I know.
It's shocking. The way that they act.
Yeah. Well, we're hearing here, Martin's over on Rumble suggesting that it could be possible since Donald Trump made his announcement last night, Rumble has been just been inundated. So maybe their servers aren't up to the load.
That's possible.
And Trump, you're done.
Odyssey's probably the same story then.
Yeah, hopefully that's what numbered. It is. I know Odyssey used to, it hasn't happened in a while, it used to have that problem quite a bit. And usually it would only go down in the mornings. Yeah. And I think that's probably because they were like, we're going to do maintenance in the morning when no one's using it. Like, we're the only ones that are using it.
We're
going
to do maintenance when nobody's watching any content whatsoever. Catholic like, say, time. 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern.
Exactly. Exactly.
Because nobody has an audience at that time.
That's my theory.
That's a good
Because it would always happen during our hour. And I'm like, what on earth, dude?
All right. We got a poll on Telegram here. Trump or DeSantis? I think, by the way, Trump has more, I think his best days are behind him. He's already like 80. I don't want another.
I'm not up for 80 or
anything. I don't want another Biden in office. All right, 13% say Trump, 87% say DeSantis with 8 votes in.
Really?
Yeah, I think DeSantis
are you
is
doing a post-poll, you know, are you doing in like a post-vote poll there? Or like, can we also ask, how do they feel about their favorite food and animal since they're leaving the polls? So we want to get a...
I think I could do that, too. Let me throw this out.
Good.
Favorite food and animal. But how do I... Let me figure it out.
We got to catch them before they go home, you know, before they leave. You know, we want to make sure we get all this...
It's very important.
Good
it's
information.
Very important.
I'd have to add a bunch of different options. I don't think they could comment.
T-Storm40 says, y'all need to try New Mexico-style enchiladas. They are flat, open-faced with an egg over easy on top.
Ew.
Ooh, egg.
I would try an egg on it.
I would crush them enchiladas right now. Let me tell you. Freaking kill it. I would love a plate
of
beef enchiladas with cheese and just
you know what's weird about New Mexico is the New Mexico chili. I always found that odd.
Yeah.
I don't know how I feel about it.
Hatch chili.
It's pretty good. It's pretty good, but I don't know if I would want it regularly.
You guys are making me hungry. Stop it.
I'm thinking about Chick-fil-A after this.
Yeah, what do I get after the show? I have a bunch of stuff to move today. I need to
How's that going, by the
get
way?
Something. It sucks. It's like the worst thing in the
moving?
World.
You're moving.
It's absolutely the worst.
People may not know that you're moving.
Yeah, I'm moving away.
You're going back to California.
Yeah, so I was going to do this tomorrow, but...
Gavin Newsom recruited you. You're working for the governor now, I heard.
I'm going back to California.
You're his communications director.
I can't
director.
Stand it here anymore.
Yeah.
That's why he's sitting down.
You know, I've been lying to you all. I'm actually a liberal.
We all knew that.
He's a communist infiltrator. I'm a communist. Catholic drive time.
My work has been done. I've left my impression on Joe, and...
Alberto asks, Joe, what happened to the carnivore diet? It's still happening, unfortunately. the death and destruction is still taking place right now. I did 3 months. I finished my 3-month tour while I was on vacation. And now I'm doing another 3 months. So I'm probably going to stay on until 1st of Feb.
How's your gout?
Been great. That's why I'm doing it. You know, unfortunately, it means I can't eat great things like enchiladas. But
have you tried? I'm sure you can do it still.
The upside is I don't have the gout problems. I don't have the sciatica problems that I was having before, and I've lost a ton of weight. So there's that. But the instant I go back and get off carnivore and I like eat enchiladas, I will gain 87,000 pounds overnight. And we're going to be... that's why I'm not getting rid of...
You got to take it slow.
That's why I'm not getting rid of any of my clothes, because I'll just going to need them again.
Hopefully not.
Yeah, well, I've been down this. This ain't my first rodeo. We'll see. Forrest says, he devil and Rudy Carlos?
He devil.
What is that supposed to mean, Forrest?
He's calling me a devil.
He's calling you the devil.
I think he's making the devil and Karl Marx reference.
Ah.
The devil and Rudy Carlos.
Oh.
Yep. I see. Yep. Sharon says, in the course of scrolling social media, I see you on Twitter, Facebook, Rumble, and YouTube.
Wow. There you go. We're everywhere.
Yeah.
By the way, I'm not actually moving back to California. I'm moving up north to a different part of Houston. And it's...
I like how you said up north.
Better.
Yeah, I'm still way more north than you are.
You're 30 minutes more north than I am.
You're like right down the road, and you're like up north, like it's the tundra or something. It's hilarious.
It looks very different up there than where I am right now. Mm-hmm.
Craig says he would want DeSantis with Trump as VP for entertainment purposes.
No, wow. Dude.
If I was to have a co-ticket, I would rather have Trump at the top of the ticket. Have Trump with DeSantis as VP. But honestly, I don't think DeSantis should do that.
Trump is not a supportive role.
Yeah, he wouldn't be. It'd be horrible.
He's too hard-headed. He's too choleric.
Yeah.
Between DeSantis and Trump, I don't know. I'm conflicted. I think I probably would go for Trump. I'm not 100%
for real?
Sure. Yeah.
Ooh, man. Salsa verde on eggs. Yeah. That sounds so yummy.
Oh, I had eggs yesterday with potatoes. Put some salsa on that. Ooh, if you have an HEB near you, get that Chipotle salsa. Oh, man, it's so good.
I can't keep talking about food, man.
I'm sorry. I think you can't have that, Joe. Never mind.
The week after Thanksgiving, I'm going to do
That's next week.
Week-long.
What is going on?
Yeah, egg diet. Right? I'm going to do a dozen eggs a day for a week.
Yeah.
Try that.
We've been butchering up the deer we harvested over the weekend.
Yeah, I noticed you brought us some.
Yeah. Anyway, moving on. I got one more deer to do tonight, so we'll be having some of that over Thanksgiving. Looking forward to it, too.
Mm.
Damon says, we're going to have you boys over for some deer meat if you're up for it.
Who, Damon?
No, the two of you can come over for deer meat.
Oh, Damon, I've never had deer before.
Damon said, deer meat is great.
So good, dude.
Damon says, I always liked the white tiger, and I like Pomsky for a mixed dog.
They're Pomsky. Cute. They're very cute.
Huh, interesting.
I don't like mixed animals.
Hey, let me ask this more serious question real quick before we get sidetracked with food and dogs. Do you guys think that this whole rocket into Poland thing is a
false flag?
Yeah. Something like that to draw in greater conflict from around the world. I mean, NATO is convening to talk about options here. If they do anything to Russia at this point,
it's over.
World War III.
Dude.
Not just in theory, 100%
over.
But in reality.
Yeah.
It's a good thing I got that scope.
Good luck with the eye relief on that one.
No, the whole idea that everybody, like Jack Posobiec was saying how if there was he tweeted out and I was really shocked. Let me see if I can find the tweet if I can read it to you. And I was shocked at his response. Mm-hmm. He basically said like, well, there needs to be bloodshed. If because of this, and I'm like, dude, don't be calling for World War III.
Right,
like,
Jack what is wrong with said
Jack Posobiec? And dude, I was like, dude, what on earth?
That's so dangerous.
Come on, dog.
Jack Posobiec said, if this was a deliberate attack on the sovereign territory of Poland, it must be repaid in blood.
Dude, in blood, no. In blood.
No. Stop being
a
war hawk.
Now I'll say this. Now I think I've made it fairly clear of my thoughts on Donald Trump. He was not my preferred choice.
There was peace in the world.
Was he better than Hillary Clinton? Of course. That's not even a real question. Like, duh. but I would choose DeSantis over Trump, I think. But I'll say this. Donald Trump's foreign policy, a breath of fresh air compared to George W. Bush.
Best we've had in like over a decade.
Several decades.
Yeah.
Bush's dad, Obama, Clinton. I mean, you name it. The Republican or Democrat, Donald Trump would, if he were in office, would not allow us to go to World War III over this.
Yeah.
You know what, though? I don't believe this narrative that media is setting up for us. They're like, oh, it's Trump versus DeSantis. Oh, Trump said this and then knocked him down. I think they're probably friends in real life.
Maybe.
I think they would inform each other if any one of them got into the office.
Well, I think if either of them got into office, I don't know. Trump has a really big ego, so it's hard to tell. But it might
be theatrics, though. He does have a big ego, but I think it's like it's inflamed when he's like on camera. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's probably true.
Why is
I don't know. Don Paddock had a really good point. He said we should have Trump with Adrian on the ticket. And I think that would really, really make it solidify that. I think so.
Why? Well, I just noticed something. Maybe you guys are cool and hip and young. I'm old and I don't understand. So please interpret for me. But why is the Twitterverse ripping Jimmy Fallon? There's the hashtag RIP Jimmy Fallon.
Jimmy Fallon.
I don't think he actually died, did he?
Yeah, he's dead.
Jimmy Fallon's dead?
He's not dead. This has got to be just memes.
His career? He's not funny, by the way.
It's over for him.
Like, what happened?
It's over.
No, seriously, I'm asking a serious question.
I have no idea.
Like, I don't think he actually died. I just think they're ripping him. They're giving him a hard time.
He's,
so, like,
he's alive.
What did he do?
It's just random things that whenever media
it's
randomly
a death
will say.
Hoax.
Yeah, the death hoaxes happen.
No, I don't think. I'm looking at all this. It doesn't look like a death hoax. It looks like they're just giving him a ribbing. Like, why though? Like, what did he do? I'm just.
I don't know, because like, right, for instance, one of them, they put RIP Jimmy Fallon, and it's James Corden.
Right. That's my point. I mean, there's all kinds of them that are just like, they're obviously just giving him a hard time. And I just and
someone said, I can't believe he died of ligma.
Oh, no. That's not appropriate.
This one's is the other guy, the other late night host. They're just joking, dude.
But it's why, though? Like, what it sparked
happens,
it?
I don't know. It happens randomly.
Come on, man.
The other day,
you're
remember,
supposed I supposed to know I was, this stuff. They're you're, saying you're just that, for laughs. You know?
They're just saying Elon Musk died and the Pope died and everyone.
Can
does,
you guys start a hoax for me? That would be hilarious.
Nobody would care.
Yeah, nobody cares if we die. In fact, there may be a celebration. I don't know.
I wish there'd be a celebration. That means people care.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Oh, man, nobody would even notice.
I guess you're right. Let's see here. Matthew says Trump's advantage over DeSantis is his foreign policy experience. The thing about DeSantis is I feel like he's more polished. He also has real executive experience. He understands the pressures of bureaucracy and can still work in those environments and still get his agenda accomplished in spite of it all.
See, I don't really care about foreign policy at this point. I would like to see a little bit of fixing here.
But what was it about going to war?
What was it about Trump's foreign policy that I liked? I liked the fact that we were leaving those foreign locations to come back home.
Yeah, and kind of sort our house out a little
bit. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. That's what I liked about it. That's what we ought to be doing. We ought to be out of all of these countries, 7,500 countries that we send special forces and ground forces to. Let's stop that. Let's stop getting involved in all of this geopolitics everywhere so we can keep our empire going and fix our own house. I'd like to see that again. But
yeah, we'll I think because, I mean, foreign policy, he had good relations with Russia, good relations with China, good relations with Korea, good relations with the Middle East. Like, how did that happen?
With Korea. You said Korea.
Yeah,
you said Korea.
And that was unprecedented. Like, we actually had no... I don't think, if I remember correctly, I could be wrong. Someone correct me if I'm wrong. I seem to remember hearing that not a single foreign U.S. death occurred with the military during the Trump presidency. Hmm. And I was like, if that's true, that's pretty amazing. For 4 years, not a single military death on the foreign land. That's pretty awesome. And now we're on the brink of war with everyone. We're on the brink of World War III. Mm-hmm. And the whole thing with Poland, you know, there's rumors. The first rumors that came out was that Russia did it. And of course, people were immediately saying, okay, well, they were not intending to hit Poland. It was they're trying to attack Ukraine, but it was too close to the border. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, I mean, Poland has to do something if that's the case. They can't do nothing because then they show weakness and they're like, oh, we're going to just let you fire rockets on our border and then accidentally kill our citizens. So they have to do something. So will Russia apologize? Will they make reparations?
Russia said they had nothing to do with it.
And then Russia came out and said they had nothing to do with it. So and was it Ukraine?
And American intelligence is saying that it wasn't.
Yeah, so some people were saying it was Ukraine. And that Ukraine did it, and they're trying to cause a false flag. It's right. Some people are saying it was an accident, and Ukraine didn't mean to do it. But I've heard people saying that there's a false flag from Ukraine trying to basically get the UN into it, trying to get NATO to actually to get in middle of this. Because if Poland's attacked, well, that's World War III. Because NATO will have to get involved. They're required by treaty to get involved.
Yeah, exactly.
So then, what do we do?
Shady.
This is huge, and someone needs to be punished for this. I don't mean punished because of by war. I mean if Ukraine
by blood
did do this, if Ukraine did this and it was a false flag, they need to be punished. If that means withdrawing support, if that means pulling their money, if it whatever it means, someone has to be punished for this because we cannot. Let people say it's okay to try to start World War III. This is big.
Yeah. You know, remember when under the Trump presidency, we executed one of Iran's generals?
Soleimani?
Yeah. Wasn't that the guy's name? Mm-hmm. And the scuttlebutt is that Trump talked to Iran and said, listen, you're going to have to do something in reprisal. You know, we understand you got to do something, but be careful in what you do. Because we don't want to escalate things. So they fired missiles into the oblivion, essentially, where nobody could get hurt. No, nothing serious could happen.
And that was like, okay, great. It's over. We did our thing. You did your thing. We can all just move on now. Like, that's pretty smart, man. That's pretty based. So something like that. I'm just trying to talk like the kids these days.
Interesting.
Something like that, base no cap.
Far.
Yeah, exactly. Something like that could happen, you know, where Poland calls Vlad or Zelensky and says,
"Would you call that absolutely
guys.
Based?"
No, I have no idea. But my point, is, do we think that the powers that are in control of this whole process are going to look for such opportunities to say, "Listen, we know you're going to have to make a reprisal. Tell you what, here, do this. It shows that you did something, you didn't do nothing, but at the same time, it doesn't escalate things beyond what they need to go. And then we can all just move on. And we don't have to send tens of thousands of young men, and now young women, to die for some pointless, greedy, horrible thing. Like, but is that going to happen? I don't know. I certainly hope that that we don't see an escalation here.
Sci-fi Mike,
I don't want my kids going off to this war. I just don't.
Sci-fi Mike is feeling lonely on Odyssey, so I'm going to read his comments.
Okay.
He said...
We're on Odyssey? I tried to... Yeah, I
it was working
it.
On and off all day. Oh, and man. So he said, nobody's talking about me. It's okay, Sci-fi, I'm talking about you. He said, Jimmy asked Elon to stop the Twitter joke.
So, but what and, started the Twitter joke is what I'm trying to understand.
Some people were saying that that is because... Jimmy Fallon said that Elon Musk needs to knock it off with the jokes on Twitter. And so then everybody
so somebody
after.
Started yeah. rip yeah. Jimmy Fallon. And they're so, ripping Jimmy Fallon for sure.
He said, I would hate to threaten a newly red Florida. Could Beto win in Texas if he wasn't up against Abbott? Doubt it. I think he lost by a landslide against Abbott. I think he would have
like
lost
10%.
Yeah. I think he would have lost against against Huffines as well. He says, I like DeSantis in Florida. Same with Abbott in Texas. I'm not a huge fan of Abbott, to be honest. After the carnivore diet, is there any meat left? There's no meat left. There'll be none in the whole planet. He got in trouble the first time for being nice to Trump for the 2016 election. He's talking about DeSantis. No, that comment was Jimmy's words, not self-pity. Oh. Okay, there you go. Mm-hmm. So there is the... and he said pizza is his favorite food. There you go, folks.
Nice. Man, that is... That is chuggy right there.
What?
Chuggy?
Pizza?
Chuggy.
It's so chuggy.
Chuggy.
Sugarwell?
Chuggy? Is it chuggy?
What are you saying?
You young people use this all the time.
I've chuggy. Never heard this before.
Are you talking about goyslop?
Dude, that's dope, man, that you would know that. It's dope.
this is cringe.
Anyway.
I'm going to die of cringe because of that.
Dude, Gucci.
What on earth? I think Joe just Googled millennial saying, Gen Z saying, or something like that, and just reading them off because no, it makes no
dude,
sense.
No way. It hits different, man. I'm just telling you.
It hits different. It hits different, he said. Please put me out of my misery.
I'm just being a little salty. It's all good. Anyway, low key, I am worried about the. I'm worried about the digital currency being tested out. We were trying to hunt down Eric Sammons, but I don't think he's responded yet.
Did he respond to you?
No, he didn't respond to me. Did he respond to you?
I didn't reach out to him.
Okay.
I can.
He texted me. He's like, you guys are trying to get me on.
Yeah.
Why didn't you just ask me? I have to decline because your boss asked.
He said, sick, I would slay that, but sleep on, bro.
What? What are you saying? I don't think you mean what you think you mean.
No cap?
No cap.
Oh, yeah.
TBH, it would be great to have Sammons on. I'm just saying.
Yeah, it would be. T-Storm said, I'm curious
IMO.
As to people's opinions on what Abbott's been doing right now with regards to the mm-hmm. border, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Based?
Listen, no, not really.
Listen, YOLO, take advantage. That's all I'm saying.
No one says YOLO anymore, dude. No one said YOLO in the last like I don't know, right. decade.
We got a dip. That music means we got a dip.
We're getting a dip. I'm gonna yassify and yeet down below.
You guys are both stuck in like 2010s.
I'm just trying to be cool like the kids, man.
About to head out.
It's over, guys. It's over. Please pray for my sanity.
All right, tomorrow.
Between these two old guys.
Father Hust, he's a local diocesan priest, good man. We're going to talk about reverence at Holy Mass. And we'll see what else we get into. Lots of trouble anyway. Do us a favor and share us with a friend. God bless you. God love you. Have a great day. Thanks for being a part of the Catholic Drive Time team. It really does mean a lot to us. We'll see you then.
Thank you for joining us on your...
Jesus is a friend of mine.
Jesus is my friend.
Jesus is a friend of mine.
I have a friend in Jesus.
What are we talking about? Come on, man. What are we talking
Come
about?
Come on, man.
Go, Brandon. I agree.
Hey. Yo, it's you!